seasons. He knows our every weakness. Take it to the Lord in
I need thee, every hour I need thee. Oh.
thy presence, my light. Be thou my wisdom, and thou my true word. I ever with thee, and thou with me, Lord. Thou my great Father, and I thy true Son. Thou in me dwelling, and I with thee one. Riches I heed not, nor man's empty praise. Thou mine inheritance, now and always. Thou and thou only be first in my heart. High King of heaven, my treasure, thou art.
Welcome to our first service of 2021. I can't even believe it's 2021 already. I was just talking to my dad on the phone recently, talking about Y2K. And man, that seems like it was forever ago. And I guess it was 21 years ago. The world was just all bent out of shape about Y2K. And I can't even believe now it's 2021, and boy, it just makes that year of my birth, 1963, seem like really, really ancient. But it's good to see you. Well, I don't actually see you. I see a couple of guys here. But I'm glad you're here with us this morning, our very first service, which happens to be live stream only. It's pretty icy out there, not a lot of snow, but we thought it'd be much safer just to do an online service. But anyways, 2021, I'm going to talk to you this morning, this very first service of 2021, talk to you about our race. Each and every one of us are running a race. And you know what? One of these days, we're going to take our last breath, and one of these days, our hearts will stop beating, and And we're going to stand before God. The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 27, it is appointed unto men once to die, and then the judgment. So I want to remind us this morning that we are in a race. There's just so many things today that can occupy our minds. And I think it's so good just to stop. I don't know when you're going to be watching this this video, so to speak, whether you're watching it with me live right now or you'll be watching it later today or maybe in the future. But I hope these thoughts will be a help to you as we start 2021 and help to remind us all of that race that we're running. And if you happen to be watching and you're not saved, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, of course, I invite you, I encourage you to get into the race. Why? It's the greatest race that you'll ever be in. And obviously, that race leads to heaven. And of course, the other direction's not too good. It's I wouldn't want to go to hell. I wouldn't want my worst enemy to go to hell. And so we need to make sure that we're all saved. We need to make sure that we're in that race. And because one of these days we will stand before God. And boy, the devil, he's an expert at getting us off in a different direction, to get us to quit running our race, to get out of the race. And so hopefully this lesson will be a help to us. We're going to look at Hebrews chapter number 12. And Hebrews chapter number 12 talks about that race. Hebrews 12 verse 1. The Bible says, "Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses." You know, sadly for us, that crowd of witnesses got bigger this year. I did many funerals this year, many dear people that I love dearly. And they're in that cloud of witnesses right now, and many that have gone before them are in that cloud of witnesses right now, looking down upon us. And the Bible says, "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses." Look at this here. It says, "Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us." And you know, Paul's telling us here that this race is not easy. We're going to have to lay aside the weights and lay aside the sins which easily get us off track, which easily hurt our race. Then he says this here. He says, "Then let us run." Let us run. And I like how he says that. Let us run. It's an invitation to run. Let us run how? With patience. Oh my goodness, what a New Year's resolution that would be for most of us. Just to have more patience. And you know, there's a scripture that says, "In your patience possess ye your souls." Wow, that's a pretty powerful scripture right there. So we need to run our race with patience. Look at this here. "That is set before us." You know, I like to sit at the table, and I like they bring food at the restaurant, and the restaurant's open tomorrow, from what I understand, that they bring that food and they set it before you. And you know, God has set a race before us. We don't have a choice, really. Say, "I don't want a race. You know, I want to be saved, and I want to go to heaven when I die, but I don't want a race." It doesn't work that way. When you get saved, you automatically get a race, and God puts a race before you. You know, my race is different than your race. We all have a race that God has set before us. Let's look at 1 Corinthians chapter number 9. And verse number 24, the Bible says, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize." So run, Paul says here, run that ye may what? Obtain. Obtain the prize. And that's what God has for us at the end of this race. And I'm so glad the Bible talks about the race is not for the quick or the swift. And I'm so glad about that, because I'm not too quick anymore and I'm not too swift anymore. You know, the race is about just plodding, about going, about keeping going for God. I think about that story about the tortoise and the hare, and how the tortoise, you know, won that race, not because of his ability, because he simply just kept going and kept going. And that's what I want to talk to you about today, about running the race that God has set before us. How can we have a great 2021 by getting in the race and by running the race that God has set before us. And let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, I do thank you for this opportunity that we can have church online this morning and the technology that allows that. And thank you for these men that are here this morning helping with that so that we can get the word of God out this morning, even though we can't come to the church. And Lord, anybody that's listening to this message, I pray that they'll be encouraged. I pray that, Lord, they'll be encouraged to get in the race and they'll be encouraged to run their race that you have set before them. And Lord, if there's anybody that's not saved that may listen to this video or watch this live, Lord, I pray that you'll speak to their hearts about that. And I pray that they would be saved. What a wonderful way to start the new year by trusting you as their personal Savior. Lord, speak to our hearts today. And I ask it all in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, there's a few things that I'm going to talk about this morning is how can we have a great race in 2021? How can 2021 be a great year for us? And some things I want to encourage you to do, scriptural principles that we need to do. First thing is this, keep your focus on the purpose, which is Jesus Christ. Keep your focus on the purpose. You know, I feel like a broken record. Many times and recently in sermons, Wednesday night Bible studies, I've been talking about this very thing, about keeping our focus. And boy, every time I talk about it, I feel like here I am again putting this in this sermon, and I mention it over and over and over again like a broken record. But you know, focus is so important. Our flesh is so weak. We get so easily put off, out of focus. And boy, just I talk to the folks in church sometimes even about praying. And boy, I'm embarrassed to say sometimes you kneel down and you talk to God, and all of a sudden something pops into your mind, something that you have to do, something going on in your life. And you kind of shake it off and you apologize to God and you say, oh, I'm sorry for getting off track here. And you pray. And sometimes even praying, it's hard to keep focus. And you come to church and sit in the pew, the first thing you want to do is look around, check everything out, check everybody out. You're looking at the lights, you're looking at everything, you know, and we're not focused. And that's just one thing that the devil uses in our lives, you know. We lose focus, and if we don't have focus, we're going to get in a heap of trouble. You know, Hebrews chapter number 12, the very next verse, verse number 2, talks about that. It talks about being compassed with so great a cloud of witnesses. It talks about running the race that is set before us. And the very first thing that it says after that is looking unto Jesus. You know, it's so important in 2021 that we keep our focus on Jesus Christ. And you know, our country right now, wow, you use the word unprecedented over and over again in 2020. And I've used that word till I myself become sick of it. Unprecedented. And our country this week, January 6th, very, very big date going on in Washington, D.C. And a lot of stuff going to be going on. And boy, a lot of focus will be on Washington, D.C. on January the 6th. And I understand that. I really do. And there's so much other things, so many other things going on in the world, right? And then your personal life, so many things going on. And boy, if we're not careful, we'll lose sight of Jesus. If we're not careful, we'll lose sight of the Lord Jesus Christ. And so the very first thing we need to do if we want to have a wonderful 2021 is we need to keep our focus on the purpose. Keep our focus on the race that God has set before us. And it says here, looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, Jesus Christ. It says, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame. And we need to remember this. Focus on this, folks. It says right here, he is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Jesus Christ is alive today. And he sits up in heaven, and he's on the right hand of the Father. And the Bible says he ever liveth to make intercession for us. So what do we need to do? Hey, we need to keep our focus right in 2021. Hey, keep your focus on Jesus Christ, and He is the finish line. One of these days, we're going to be with the Lord. We're going to meet Him in the air, and it's going to be a wonderful, wonderful reunion. The book of 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 talks about that happy reunion, talks about the dead in Christ rising first. We which are alive and remain shall be caught up together. We're all going to meet the Lord, and the Bible says, so shall we ever be with the Lord. So we need to keep our focus on Jesus. You know, if there's anybody that knew how to do that, it was the Apostle Paul. The Apostle Paul, I think perhaps more than anybody in the Bible, his focus was on the Lord Jesus Christ. I like what Paul said in Philippians chapter 3 and verse number 14. You could probably quote this verse. He said this, he said, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of God in Christ Jesus. Paul kept his eyes on the Lord Jesus Christ. And you know, it's no wonder why God picked him to write so much of the Bible. It's no wonder why God picked him really to just cause the churches and the gospel to flourish. And Paul did some amazing things. And why is that? Because he had an amazing God. He had an amazing Savior. And what did Paul do in his life? He kept his focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. Hey, don't get me wrong. We should be very concerned about our world. We should be very concerned about what's going on in Washington, D.C., because it does affect our lives in a direct way. I'm not saying we shouldn't be concerned about these things. We should for sure, as Christians, we should be praying for our country. We should be voting. We should be doing all those things. But hey, let's let our focus in 2021 be on the Lord Jesus Christ. I like what Proverbs says, the book of wisdom. It says, Proverbs chapter 4, verse 25, let thine eyes look right on. Let your eyes look right on. It says, and let thine eyelids look straight before thee. You know, sometimes we focus on the wrong things. Three things I'll just touch on briefly. Sometimes we have a tendency to focus on the past. And wow, you know, Paul in another scripture, he said, forgetting those things which are behind. You know, so much of our focus can be on the past. Maybe you made a decision a long time ago. It's still affecting your life. But, you know, don't focus on that. You know, you wish you would have done things differently. We can't focus on that. What do we have to do? Focus on today. Focus on the future. Hey, let me encourage you. Do not focus on your past. You know, Luke chapter 9 has a wonderful scripture about that. Maybe you know that scripture, Luke chapter 9, verse number 62. The Bible says, and Jesus said unto him, no man having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God. Think about that. That's pretty powerful scripture right there. No man having put his hand to the plow and looking back. You know what's going to happen? You're going to get off track. You ever been driving and you focus on the rearview mirror too much? Or you get your eyes off the road where you're heading, and boy, you're going to veer off the road. You're going to crash. And so we have to get our focus off of the past. And I promise you, we all have regrets. We've all made boneheaded decisions. But get your mind off of the past and maybe how you missed the boat, quote unquote, or all these different things. Why? Because it's going to hinder your future and it's going to affect your future in a great way. So let's not focus on the past. Hey, how about this? Here's another problem we have. We focus on people. We focus on people. And boy, it's terrible to do. You get your eyes on people. You know, the Bible's pretty good book, obviously, and God himself tells us to not compare ourselves one with another. And we're not supposed to keep our eyes on people or on man. And we'll get ourselves in trouble. And, you know, social media really adds to this problem. And you know, usually when people post something on Facebook, they're not posting the dirt. They're posting the best. They're posting all the positive. They're not going to tell you about all their dirt. And so you look on Facebook and you say, wow, why can't I be that fortunate? Or why can't my life be going like hers or like his? Or hey, let me tell you something. You don't know the real story. You don't know what's going on in anybody's life, you know. Don't focus on people. Don't become covetous. Don't wish you had somebody else's life or somebody else's race. You know the old cliche, the grass always looks what? Greener on the other side. But you know, I guarantee you, they got as much dirt on their side of the fence as you have, maybe even more dirt. And so, hey, don't make the mistake in 2021 of focusing on people. We can become obsessed with people, especially in this day of social media, just obsessed with certain people, obsessed with it. And hey, get your focus off of people. Get your focus off your past and keep your focus on the Lord Jesus Christ. And here's another thing, problem. We like to focus on our problem. And you know, and the problems that we have, and I'm not making light of anybody's problems, but you know, usually in our minds, our problems are way bigger in our minds than they really are. Hey, how many of you as parents, you have little children, and boy, that situation that's going on in their life is so big to them. And as a parent, you look at that situation and you think, wow, that is just the littlest problem in the world. Wait till you grow up. Wait till you get a job. Wait till you have bills. Wait till you, then you talk about problems, right? But you know, as a parent, we say, hey, don't worry about that. That's just a little thing. Don't even worry. But to that child, it's the biggest thing ever. And you know, we're the same way. And the devil is an expert at making our little problems seem insurmountable and bigger than we can handle. But we know that there's no thing too big for us to handle. Why? Because we have God. And nothing is too big for God to handle. So let me encourage you on this first point. Hey, let's keep our focus on the purpose. Let's keep our focus on our race. Let's keep our focus on Jesus Christ. Hey, the eternal, not our past, not other people, not our problem. Hey, those things are very real, but let's not have focus on that. Let's focus on the Lord Jesus Christ if we want to win that race and finish that race, finish the course that God has set before us. Here's another thing. Not only keep your focus, but keep your feelings harnessed. Keep your feelings harnessed in 2021. You know, our feelings, wow. The seat of our emotions, we call it the heart. Now, obviously, we have a physical heart, organ that pushes blood through your body and feeds your body with oxygen and all these things that our body needs. And the heart is so important. It's the center, really, of all of our organs. It's the center of our being, our hearts. That's the seat of our emotion. And our emotions can get us in a lot of trouble. Hey, have you been there? Have you been there? Boy, I've been there. And boy, if we want to have a good year in 2021, if we want to have a good race, we need to be very, very careful about our feelings, keep our feelings harnessed. Why? Because the Bible warns us of, again, a familiar scripture, Jeremiah 17 and verse number 9. The heart is deceitful above all things, and desperately wicked. Who can know it? Wow. The heart, that seat of emotion, is deceitful. You know, I kind of cringe when I hear people say, well, just follow your heart. I can understand what they're talking about. And I've said it myself before. I've thought those thoughts. But really, we must be careful. We must be, now don't get me wrong, God will speak to our hearts, different things like that. But just purely following your heart, without God being involved will just might get you in a whole heap of trouble, as I found out in my life, and perhaps some of you could say amen, preacher, to that point this morning. But anyways, the heart is deceitful. So we need to be very, very careful to keep our feelings harnessed in 2021. Probably the greatest emotion, the greatest feeling that we experience many times, especially today, is fear. What an emotion fear is. Fear keeps people from a lot of wonderful things. Fear keeps people from getting saved. Because they think, wow, I don't want to get saved. If I get saved, you know, I'll become one of these religious nuts, and, you know, the church will get all my money and God will get all my time, and I'm living my own life, you know. So we'll fear even getting saved. We'll fear running the race. We'll fear trying to follow God. Why? Because, man, he'll make me a missionary somewhere in the deepest jungles of Africa or something like that. But we're afraid. You know, you won't see it on the screen this morning. This is a late add-in. But 2 Timothy 1:7, it says, "For God hath not given us a spirit of fear." God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of a sound mind. So, folks, if God didn't give us a spirit of fear, who do you think did? The devil. He wants us to be fearful. And you know, so many times we can look at the New Testament, we can look at those scriptures, we can look at the stories, and people were so fearful. And Jesus sometimes would even say, "Why are you so fearful? Why are you fearful?" Well, we know the reason. Same reason why I become fearful. It's a lack of faith. It's a lack of trusting God. And so we need to be very careful about keeping our feelings harnessed. And the number one feeling that we have to be careful of and we have to battle is fear. You know, a great president one time, well, arguably a great president one time, said, "The only thing to fear is what? It's fear itself." And fear holds so many people back from the blessings of God and from victory, really. But feelings of fear. Just quickly, I'm going to go over several of them here that really get us in some trouble. Feelings of pride. You know, we get so full of pride. You know, I want to remind you, the Bible says in Proverbs chapter number 6 and verse number 16, again, it's a late add-in, you won't see it on the screen. But Proverbs chapter 6, "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him." Verse 17 says, the very first one, and you know what it is? A proud look. A proud look. You know, pride is the very first sin that God ever laid his eyes on. When the devil said, "I will ascend, I will be above the Most High," the devil was so full of pride, full of conceit. And there's so many scriptures about pride. Of course, I just mentioned the one in Proverbs 16. There's another very popular one in Proverbs 16, verse 18, "Pride goes before destruction." Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. And you know, pride will cause us to fall flat on our face. Do you want to fall flat on your face? Well, then just be prideful. Boy, I know I've had it happen to me many, many times. You know, there's no greater humbler than God. God knows how to put us in our place. God knows how to humble us. So we need to be careful to have those feelings of pride. You know, we put on a suit or some nice clothes or a nice watch or jewelry or a coat or whatever. And we think we're somebody, or we live in a certain neighborhood, or we live in a certain house, or we drive a certain make and model of a car. And, you know, we think that we're somebody, but you know what? We're nothing. All we are is a bunch of sinners saved by grace. Paul said it so well. He said, "In my flesh dwells what? Nothing good. Nothing good." So I don't know why really we have a problem with pride when we're such pitiful creatures when you really think about it. But yet we do. We struggle with pride. We say, I'm okay, when we're not okay. When we say, I don't need that sermon, and we do need that sermon. We say, I don't need that person in my life. As a matter of fact, I don't need anybody. You know that's a lie too, all right? And there's so many ways that we just puff ourselves up. But, oh, listen, we need to battle those feelings of fear. We need to battle those feelings of pride. This one's a little different. Those feelings of excitability, you know. Sometimes we get ourselves in trouble when we get in a good mood. Have you ever made a purchase? Maybe when you're in this good mood. We call it Christmas spirit. That's what they call it now. If there was ever a wrong term, that's a wrong term. But we get in the spirit. And we get home after a shopping excursion. We think, my goodness. You look at that bag and you look at all those things in that bag. And you think, man, I didn't need that. The person I bought it for don't need it either. And what do? We just spend our money. We do things when we're all in a good mood and we're excited. You know, I'm reminded of Peter, how at the Mount of Transfiguration, man, he saw something amazing. He saw Jesus in his transfigured form, and man, he got all excited. He said, God, it's good for us to be here. Man, let us make his tabernacles. Let's do this. And God said, whoa. I'm out. So, hey, I'm for being excited. I'm for excitement. Only if it's real, though, you know. Only if it has some substance to it. Because sometimes we make emotional purchases. We make emotional decisions. Man, how many of us have ever gotten in trouble making an emotional purchase? Making an emotional decision to quit a job or leave a relationship, whatever it is. And you say, man, later on, you say, man, I messed that up. So we must be very careful about our excitability. Be careful when you're in a good mood, because sometimes you'll make bad decisions. And you know, I know that's a little bit of a weird point there, but we have to be careful about that kind of stuff. And here's the last emotion we'll talk about, and a very big one, anger. Feelings of anger. Man, I can think about people in the Bible that got angry, and I can think about Jonah. He preached the greatest revival known to man, and he got mad about it, got angry with God because he spared the Ninevites. And God said to Jonah, doest thou well to be angry? You know, anger, there's two kinds of anger, and I taught on anger a few years ago. There's what you call a righteous anger, a righteous indignation, right? And that's the kind of anger that God has. Or we have what's called sinful anger. Because things don't go our way, or people don't act like we want them to act, or people do not respond like we want them to respond, then we get angry. And that's a sinful anger. And we know what God says about sinful anger in the book of Ephesians chapters 4 and verse number 26. It says, be angry, yes, righteous anger. There's a lot of things in this world we should be angry about. But God says this, be angry and sin not. God says, avoid sinful anger. It'll hurt you in a great way. And God says this. He said, neither let the sun go down upon your wrath. Don't let that anger carry over to the next day and the next day. Then it becomes hate. Then it becomes bitterness. And, oh, we have to be careful. Hey, we need to keep our feelings harnessed. In 2021, I'm not saying it's easy, folks. This flesh is powerful. This flesh is strong. And our feelings, man, they get flared up. I mean quick. And sometimes it's hard to extinguish them. Sometimes we fail to extinguish them, and then later we're embarrassed. Later we're apologetic. Man, I'm sorry I said that, and so on and so forth. But it says, be angry, but sin not. Neither let the sun go down upon your wrath. The very next verse is very interesting. I say it every time, most every time I teach on this passage. The very next verse says, neither give place to the devil. Because our emotions, man, that's giving place to the devil. Hey, you want to have a great year in 2021. Keep your focus. Hey, keep your feelings harnessed. Here's another one. Keep your feet moving. Keep your feet moving. Hey, don't quit. Don't quit. Keep your feet moving. You ever hear a coach screaming from the sidelines? Keep your feet moving. You know, you play defense with your feet, right? And boy, so many drills and practice. So many drills, just your feet. I mean backwards and forwards and sideways. Keep your feet moving. And boy, that applies to just about every sport. Keep your feet moving. Hey, it also applies to life. Keep your feet moving. Don't quit. You know, I'm getting at that age now. You know, I sit down and my feet stiffen up. My two artificial knees stiffen up. And without fail, every time I stand up, I got to start moving my knees, moving my feet. And guess what? I start out like this. You know, walking like Fred Sanford. I probably shouldn't have just said that. But you know Fred Sanford, you remember him from the old TV show. But I'm walking like Fred, you know. If you remember how Fred used to walk. But after a while, guess what? Man, I'm stretched out and I'm walking. Hey, guess what? I can still run. But you know, after I sit down a while and I get all stiffed and then it just takes me a while to get limber again, you know. And I know that's not you at this point in your life, but you just wait. It's going to happen. I used to be young and cocky too, right? But anyways, let me encourage you in 2021 to keep your feet moving. Wow, what a temptation. I think the temptation is probably greater than ever to just throw in the towel. Just quit. Well, we got the devil fighting against us. We have our own flesh fighting against us. And boy, for sure we have the world fighting against us, especially now. I could go on and on about that, but I'm not going to right now. But we do have so many things working against us. I'm not trying to give an excuse, but I'm just saying, if there was ever an easier time just to keep the church doors shut, just to quit, if anybody ever needed an excuse, this is it. 2020 was about the best excuse you'll ever get to just quit across the board. And people would say, boy, I can understand. It's been a tough year. I can understand. And we'd get some sympathy from people. But, you know, we got getting back to point number one, we need to keep our focus on Jesus. Jesus kept his feet moving. Jesus kept going. I mean, he set his face towards that cross right there. He set his face, and guess what? There were so many things trying to stop him, namely the devil. And even Peter said, you're not going to do that. You're not going to die if I have anything to do with it. And what did Jesus say to Peter? Think about this. Get thee behind me, what? Satan. Called him Satan. Because Jesus said, you're not going to keep me from what I was born to do. I'm going to keep going. I think about the Bible. It's filled with people that had excuses to quit. Think about Joseph for a minute. Talk about a rough life. Talk about being stabbed in the back by his own brother. You talk about being stabbed in the back by Potiphar's wife. You talk about somebody that could have been bitter. You talk about somebody that could have quit trusting God and hated God. Man, God, you gave me these dreams, and now look. Now look, I'm in this pit. You gave me these dreams, and now look. Now I'm in prison. But I think about Joseph. Guess what? He kept going. He kept going. He kept his feet moving. I think about that very last chapter of the book of Genesis, where Joseph told his brothers, "You meant evil for me, but God meant it for what? God meant it for good." You know what Joseph did? He looked back in his life and he saw a lot of hard times. He saw a lot of times where he could have got angry at God, angry at people, kind of got bitter. But what did he do? He just kept going. He kept trusting God. He kept going. And guess what happened in the end? He was blessed. He was blessed. I think about David. Think about that. Samuel came to his house when he was just a youth and anointed him with oil in front of his dad, in front of his whole house. David was anointed king. Well, when did he become king? Not for a long time. A long time. David had to do a lot of things. He had to go through a lot of things before he actually sat on that throne. But let me tell you, David, he kept trusting God. Read the Psalms. He lamented. He wept. He had all kinds of things. But he kept going. And guess what Jesus is called today? Jesus is called the Son of David. David, think about that. The greatest king that Israel ever knew outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. But David kept his feet moving. Let me encourage you, keep your feet moving. You know the old saying, it's an old cliche. An idle mind is what? I think I almost heard you say it. An idle mind is the devil's workshop. And boy, you just do nothing. You just sit down and do nothing. Now, don't get me wrong, we need rest. Jesus went apart and rested. We need rest. But let me encourage you in 2021, keep your feet moving. Obviously, if you're running a race, your feet need to be moving. Hey, your Christian walk, keep your feet moving. Your relationships. And boy, some of you right now are struggling in some relationships and you just want to quit. You just want to walk away from that relationship. Keep your feet moving. Don't quit. I mean, you want to quit your job. You want to quit your church, maybe. I don't know. You want to quit. But let me encourage you. As you run your race in 2021, keep your feet moving. What did Paul say? I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling. Paul kept his feet moving. Here's another thought. A couple more and we're done. Want to have a good 2021? Keep the fuel flowing. Keep your fuel, I can't even say it, your fuel flowing. You know, our bodies are a machine. And if you don't put food and fluid inside this body, it's going to wither away. Before long, you'll be laying down. You won't be able to move. And you'll be in that situation for a while till eventually your heart quits pumping. You'll be dead. Why? Because our body needs energy. Our body needs protein. Our body needs fats even. Yes, fats. Our body needs carbs. Forgive me for all of you that are on low-carb diets right now. But our bodies need a lot more than that. I'm not a doctor, right? But I do know our body needs some things, obviously minerals and many other things. different vitamins. It's all very important. But just like our physical bodies need fuel, our spiritual bodies need fuel. And you know what? We get in that car and we look at that needle. Where is it? Is it full? Well, if it's full, I can go a long ways. I can go a long ways. If it's on E or towards that empty, you say, man, I'm not going to go very far. I've got to stop and get what? Some gas. I got to stop and get some fuel. And if you do not take time to do that, have you ever been there? Man, I'm too big of a hurry to stop and get fuel. Have you ever seen somebody standing on the side of the road with a gas can or walking with a gas can down the side of the road and you see their car back there? You know, that's not fun. You say, man, I'm kicking myself. I knew I needed fuel and I didn't stop. I didn't want to take the time. I didn't want to spend the money, whatever. And if you're not careful, you'll find yourself walking. You'll find yourself stalled out on the side of the road. Hey, our spiritual lives in 2021, if we're not careful, we'll find ourselves stalled out on the side of the road. We'll be stalled out on the side of the road. Why? Because we have no fuel. Now, of course, our spiritual bodies need spiritual fuel, obviously. And I'm not going to spend much time on each one of these things, but what are some spiritual fuel? What is some spiritual fuel that our bodies need? Our spiritual bodies. Well, first of all, we need the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit gives me fuel to keep going. The Holy Spirit gives me power, literally power, to keep going. You know, the day you got saved, the Holy Spirit came in. He came in. And you know what? You have the Holy Spirit. He's there. He's speaking to you. He's convicting you. He's leading you. All these different things. Now, yes, we can grieve him, like it says in Ephesians chapter 4. We can quench the Spirit, like it says in Thessalonians chapter number 5. We can quench the Spirit. We can grieve the Spirit. We need to be careful about those things. Why? Because we're emptying our fuel tank. But like Jesus said, be filled with the Spirit. And the Lord says that. We need to be filled with the Spirit. Why? Because we need fuel. Let me encourage you to be filled with the Spirit. Galatians 5 talks about walking in the Spirit. And you shall not fulfill the lust of the flesh. Why? Because it gives you that strength, that fuel that we need. So in 2021, we need to keep the fuel flowing. The Holy Spirit. Be sensitive to the Holy Spirit. Yield to the Spirit. Hey, how about this fuel, the Word of God? The Word of God, what a fuel it is. You know, the Bible says faith cometh by hearing. You won't see it. You won't see it on the screens this morning. Romans 10:17. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. You want your faith increased? Well, get in the book more. Hey, listen to more preaching from the Word. What will it do? Man, it'll give you fuel. That's why God says in Hebrews 10:25, not to forsake the assembly of yourselves together. It's not so the church can run your life. Some people sadly think that. I've had people pretty much tell me that. Hey, preacher, just so you know, I'm not going to let the church run my life. Well, you know what? I'm not going to try to run your life. This church is not going to try to run your life. That's just thoughts that the devil puts in your head. No, but God is trying to run your life. And many times those are just excuses so we can just do our own thing and live our own lives. But hey, the church is important. Why? Because it's a place you come to get fueled up. Yeah, but preacher, there's people there. Yeah, There's people there. Yeah, but preacher, there's problems there. Yeah, there's problems sometimes in the church. But there's also problems in the world. What are we going to do, lock ourselves in our house forever? Man, I'm not going to go out in the world. Why? There's problems out there. Well, I'm not going to go to work tomorrow because there's people there. There's problems there. We don't do that, do we? Because we need this. We need that paycheck. But hey, listen, we need church. Yes. Church can be frustrating. Yes, the pastor sometimes can frustrate you. People in the pews will frustrate you. Different things, many things. But that doesn't mean we it's not important. It's important. And so let me encourage you. Keep the fuel flowing, the Holy Spirit, the Word of God. I love what Jeremiah said. Let me read it to you. Jeremiah 15:16. And you will see this on the screen, God willing. Thy words were found, and I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of mine heart. Wow. Thy words was the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. For I am called by thy name, O Lord God of hosts. How many times have we read the Bible and those words just did something to us? They strengthened us, and they give us fuel. Oh, the Word of God. And I think about the brethren, even the guys that are here this morning. They give me fuel. They help keep me going. I hope in some small way I help you keep going. I hope I can be fuel for you. And let me encourage you, let's be fuel for each other. Hebrews 3 says it like this. Hebrews 3 says it like this, verse 13. But exhort one another. Exhort one another daily while it is called today. Why? Lest any of you be hardened through the deceitfulness of sin. So we need each other. We need to exhort one another, encourage one another. And then lastly, in closing, we need to keep our fire burning. You want to have a good race. You want to have a good year in 2021. Don't let the fire go out. You know, I love the song. Haven't sang it in a long time, but give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning, burning, burning. Give me oil in my lamp, I pray. Give me oil in my lamp. Keep me burning, burning, burning. Keep me burning. Hey, keep me burning till the break of day. And that's what we need to do. We need to keep burning. Keep the fire going. Just a couple thoughts on this. The Word of God is a fire. It's alive. It burns. And that word will burn in us and in our hearts. Look what Jeremiah says. The word of God is a fire. Jeremiah 23, verse 29. Is not my word like as a fire, saith the Lord, like a hammer that breaketh the rock in pieces? So God's word is like a fire. You know, I think about those two disciples. As they were walking to Emmaus, I think it was, and a stranger showed up. They didn't know who it was, but it was Jesus, and he was talking with them. And listen to what they said, and I know you know the story. You probably know the verse, but Luke chapter 24, verse 32. And they said one to another, did not our hearts what? Burn. Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us? You know, when God talks with us, through his word. And that's why we're supposed to read it. It burns. Keeps that fire going. You know, we have heat right now. Because downstairs, there's a fire burning. And because that fire's burning, we can enjoy heat. And so, you know, there's so many things that work against that. And boy, you can preach another message on this, and rest assured, I'm not. But so many things try to put out our fire, namely ourselves. But we got to be careful. Let me encourage you in 2021, keep your fire burning. Now, again, each and every one of us probably has a good excuse. A good excuse of why your fire is not burning. Well, we can blame so many things. Usually not ourselves, of course. But we can blame so many things why we don't have any fire for God. But there's really no good excuse. Why? We have the Holy Spirit. We have the Word of God. And the Word of God by itself is a fire. And then God Himself is a consuming fire. Deuteronomy chapter 4 and verse 24. For the Lord thy God is a consuming fire. Boy, you have God in you in the form of the Holy Spirit. So you have that fire, the possibility of a fire inside you. And then, of course, one of the best ways to keep a fire burning is just think on the right things. You know, you think on the wrong things, it's like pouring water. It's like quenching the spirit, like I talked about earlier. It's like pouring icy cold water, certain things that we think about. But boy, there's other things we think about. Man can set our hearts aflame. I think about that song. I think John R. Rice wrote it. I'm not sure. Set my soul afire, Lord. Set my soul afire. Boy. Look what David said. Psalm 39, verse 3. My heart was hot within me. My heart was hot. Why? He was thinking about the right thing. He said, my heart was hot within me while I was musing, while I was thinking. The what? The fire burned. You want to have that fire? Well, quit thinking so negatively. Quit thinking of the reasons why your fire is out. Quit making excuses. We have the Holy Spirit. We have the Bible. We have this mind that God gave us. Boy, you focus on the right things along with the Holy Spirit, along with the Word of God. You can't help but have fire. And oh, what this world needs today is a group of Christians that has the fire burning. And that's what God wants us to be, hot for Him and for His glory. Hey, I went way too long this morning. But you know what? This is important. We're running a race. We're starting out 2021 fresh. Fresh. Hey, let me encourage you. Hey, these points this morning, biblical points, biblical principles that we can use to make 2021 a great year. Hey, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for your word. Lord, I pray that you will help us all, Lord, to run our race. Help us all to be the person, the Christian that you want us to be. And these principles will help us to do that. And we ask it all in Jesus' name, amen. Hello. Just before we close out here this morning, I want to remind you tonight by 5 o'clock, we will post a sermon. I will post a sermon for tonight, and it'll be a blessing to you. Just kind of a continuation of what I was talking about this morning for 2021. On Wednesday, God willing, I will be posting a Bible study. So don't forget about that. The calendars, I'll be talking about that. We'll be sharing the calendars with you. The events, yes, we did schedule some events by faith, even though we're still in the middle of this mess that we're in. And so that'll all be forthcoming. So keep your eyes on Facebook, on your email, and we'll be talking to you about all those things in the days ahead. God bless you. Have a good evening.